Hey everyone, welcome back to The Fin Factor. I'm Paul.
And I'm Aaron.
This is episode number 47.
47, our favorite water boy, Joachim Ryan. And the only man to beat the San Jose Sharks in the Stanley Cup Finals, Mike Sullivan.
That is true. Okay, so this episode, what we're going to do is recap round two, the series against Colorado. We're going to go into a little bit of the details in that series.
And then we'll give a preview of the upcoming series against the St. Louis Blues.
Very good. You ready to start the show?
Ready.
Okay, well, if the series with Colorado has taught me anything, it's that the Fin Factor makes everyone's body tingle.
All right, well, that was funny. If you don't know what we're talking about, go back to our live episodes, and you'll figure it out from the comments.
Pretty easily.
Pretty much every single episode. Every single live show. One thing we're going to do tonight is we're going to give away some of the stuff on our set. So right here in this corner, we have a hat. We have a can cooler koozie, a beanie, some awesome socks, and a mini stick, all in playoff mode. So what we're going to do and how this is going to work is we need you to like and subscribe and comment with a hashtag when we get there. And we're going to spread these out throughout the show. So then... and we're going to pick a random winner by Saturday?
Yeah.
During our live show.
Right. So what we'll do is when we get there, we'll let you guys know which item we're going to be giving away and what the specific hashtag is for that item so that when you guys do your comments, you add that hashtag in there and we'll enter you into you know, a raffle or whatever to win that specific prize. So.
And unfortunately for the podcast people, this is going to be a YouTube-only thing, but in the future, we are going to do a podcast-only giveaway. Where we'll figure it out somehow, but it's only going to be on the podcast form of how you can win.
And you guys can double dip by listening on as a podcast and then coming over to YouTube and giving us a like and a subscribe and checking us out there.
As long as it's before Saturday, right?
There you go. Okay, so now that we got all that stuff out of the way, we're going to go ahead and start talking about the Colorado series. And I think one thing I wanted to say, and you kind of talked about it just a little bit already, was go back and check out the lives, right? If there is any information about any specific game that you're more interested in, maybe go back to one of those live shows when we have them all numbered for which game it was, and just take a look at those. Really good comments, really good questions from the live folks, and I would encourage you guys to subscribe so that you can be a part of those live shows. You'll know when we're going live. You'll know when with a notification that gets sent out to you. So, and we have the link and everything. It's very easy. You just click on it, and boom, there we are. So, yeah, definitely check out the lives for any of those specific game questions that you may have, because we probably touched on it.
Right.
Yeah.
So, going into the series of Colorado, started off, the Sharks got a win, and remember Kevin LeBanc's goal?
Yeah.
How sweet that was.
Oh, yeah.
How long ago that seems now.
It does.
Where he put the puck right through Rantanen's legs.
Yeah. Call it a nutmeg, I believe.
Or nutmeg. Yeah, that's the name in soccer.
There you go.
That seems so long ago. And we actually thought that was more of like a game five goal.
Yeah.
It was a game one goal.
Yeah.
But anyway, the Sharks started off hot. People were a little worried coming out of that Vegas series that they were going to be a little tired, and they ended up winning pretty. I thought that was a pretty strong showing in that game.
Sure.
Then they went on to lose game two, and everyone thought the world was going to end. And then go into Colorado, and everyone's nervous, and they win game three. So everyone goes, oh, okay, they're just going to do this in five. And then they lose game four.
Yep.
And then everyone, again, thinks that the world is going to end. And then they come back home, and everyone's like, oh, they're old, they're tired, they're not going to win. And they win game five. So everyone's like, oh, yay, we're going to win in six. And then we go into Colorado, and it goes to overtime, and thankfully it ended within a couple minutes, and we lost. And everyone said, oh, the Sharks are done. They're not going to win game seven. And then we come home for game seven, and Pavelski comes back, and we win game seven.
Goes win, loss, win, loss, win, loss, win, right? I mean, it was just a total back-and-forth series. A lot, again, this speaks to the parity in the league, right? I mean, this was a lot tougher than I thought this series was going to be. I thought that, you know, the Sharks have a lot more depth. All you have to do is shut down the McKinnon line, and then that's it. Well, that wasn't exactly the case. The nice thing, though, the Sharks never actually fell behind, right? It was always either them going up by one or tied. So I think there was kind of like a comfort level, if you will, among the players and how the series went. So
I think that speaks to the Sharks' kind of playoff experience in a way.
There you go.
They kind of like us. They don't get too high on the highs or too low on the lows, right? So it's funny, like when you look back at this series, it went win, loss, win, loss. This is kind of like how we do our show during the season, is we do a weekly show and we look back during the week rather than going game by game by game, because the emotions are so high and so low.
Right.
Especially during the regular season, there's so many games and it's so grinding out. So it's funny looking back at this and you go, wow, we didn't, you know, in hindsight, we know the Sharks won.
Right.
So you got like, oh, remember feeling that way of like, oh, they're going to be done. So anyway, I think the Sharks' depth had a lot to do with it. I think their experience had a lot to do with it. And I also think, I mentioned this in the last live, I think the Sharks got a lot of luck in this series.
Yeah.
They got lucky, I'd say, in game seven, besides the offsides call, with McKinnon getting hurt in the first 2 minutes of the game, right, and they had to leave. So I think what I heard on the radio was it wasn't
shoulder?
He strained something in his shoulder, but it wasn't. So a lot of people thought it was his collarbone, that he broke his collarbone, but it wasn't. It was like an AC joint type thing in his shoulder. So he got a cortisone shot, came back to the game, played okay, but he wasn't himself.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
You could tell he wasn't taking any faceoffs for one.
Right.
So I think the Sharks got lucky. They got a break there. Then they get that offside call. Then they get the non-tripping call on Carlson.
Right.
I mean, that's just specific to Game 7. But I think the series was close and could have gone either way. Yeah, so what
did you think? I thought it was great having Joe Pavelski back in on this Game 7, right? He leaves the previous series in Game 7, and then they have that miraculous comeback. And then all throughout the series for against Colorado, you know, games 1 through 6, our captain's missing. And then he's, you know, kind of thinking about coming back. All of a sudden, Game 7, yeah, he's skating with the team, and they're not really saying he's dressing, though. So is he going to play? Is he not? He jumps in the game, and I think it was like maybe 5-6 minutes into the game, and he makes his presence felt, right? He goes ahead and tips this Brent Burns shot from the point.
It's a
and
of course, Pavelski goal,
of course, right?
Right?
That's the way it's going to go in. Yeah. If Joe Pavelski's scoring it, right, is he's either going to one time it in, or he's going to tip it,
or he's going to take it off his mouth.
There or off the mouth. Luckily, he didn't have to take anything off the mouth this series. Yeah. So, but hey, there's always, you know, next series. So anyway, Pav's with a beautiful tip. Puck goes right past and goes in the net. So a great way to start the game off, you know, get the early lead, go up 1-0, and, you know, having your captain, the guy that's been out for so long to do it, that really pumped the boys up, I think. So he ends up with a goal and assist, I believe, in that game. So, again, the captain coming back, making his presence felt, didn't have, you know, any little bit of rust to shake off or anything, just jumped right back in and made a really great play.
I mean, the Sharks were lucky. They got to add their leading goal scorer back for Game 7, the most pivotal point in the series. And so it was good to have him back, and he looked great. He looked fantastic. Looks like he's going to ride that into the next round, hopefully. So hopefully he doesn't have any setbacks or anything going into the St. Louis game.
Yeah, hopefully. We'll see. Now, you brought up the offside call earlier, and if you hadn't seen it, I would suggest, again, checking out that Game 7 live. You can go ahead and recap on that one. But for the purpose of this show, at least, the offside call was essentially Landeskog skating from the Sharks' zone, the offensive zone, and going out to make a change, and he didn't quite get his foot across the blue line, or to the blue line, rather.
Well, the bench for Colorado is in the offensive zone of the Sharks. So normally what most players do is they'll skate and get their leg over the line, right? And then they get off on the change. So that kind of is the touch-up offsides. And Landeskog did not do that.
Right.
And from what I read online, actually, I think today, that he was dealing with some kind of minor tweak injury to his groin. He had a hard time getting over the boards, so he needs to open the door. So the blame, I was blaming him fully for this, and I think there should be some partial blame for the guys on the bench, because they know that he's hurt. He's their captain, and you see a guy coming off, and usually you open the door for him, right, to make it quick. Nobody was opening the door for him, so when you see him skating there, he takes a good 5 second count, fiddling with the door, trying to get it open. And if somebody had just opened the door, or if he could have just jumped over the boards,
which you can't do with a groin injury, right?
This wouldn't have happened. So a lot of Avs fans are blaming the refs. A lot of people are saying, you know, the refs really blew the game. But again, this is a goal that was called back in the second period of the game. Would have made it 2-2. Instead, the Sharks scored a couple minutes later, make it 3-1.
Right.
So it's kind of a swing, but at the same time, it was the second period. There was a lot of hockey left.
Sure.
So I don't think it wasn't the last minute of the game where they would have tied it, right?
Yeah.
So I don't think it's that big of a deal, and it just happened to be in Game 7. I think that's why it's a big deal.
Yeah, and at the end of the day, you know, if it's you not getting off the ice, yeah, there's a lot of blame that goes to you. And like he said, there's, you know, somebody should be opening the door for him and everything else if they know that he's, you know, struggling with this injury. But, you know, the refs have to call it the way that the rule book says it. There's no interpretation there. The guy's still on the ice. His foot's not across the line. They have to call it. And, you know, good on, I think it was Dan, I forget, they call him Double D, the video guy for the Sharks.
Yeah.
Good on him for seeing it, right? And, you know, he lets DeBoer know, DeBoer makes the call, and of course he's going to say that if, you know, hey, check out this play, make sure that we get it called back, because, yeah, you don't need to have the game tied up. Obviously, you want every advantage that you can. You can't fault a coach for giving his team every advantage as possible, right?
Right.
Especially when, by the letter of the law and the rule book, it's in violation. So, right. Yeah, all you're doing is calling it out.
Yeah, and so. funny fact about this little historical piece here is that the Colorado Avalanche were kind of the team that sparked this offsides review. Going back to the 12-13 season, sometime in February of 13, there was a game that Colorado was playing against Nashville, and Duchesne, when he was on the Colorado team, mm-hmm. Got a breakaway goal at some point, and he was clearly offsides by a mile, and the linesman missed it. But at that time, there was no reviewing it. And so people were a little bitter about it. Like, this is kind of, you know, this could be a problem. This could be a problem in a game seven in the playoffs, right? So the following season, the GMs got together and talked about it. And by the 13-14 season, they made the rule where you can challenge instant replay. Mm-hmm. You can challenge both goalie interference and offside call, which we've seen multiple times in this playoffs. Yeah. So, going back to this goal, you can blame Colorado themselves for putting this in place in a way. So they've been on both sides of the problem in a way.
Yeah.
And there was a good article about this whole thing. If this went the other way around, do you think Colorado fans would be complaining?
Right.
If it helped Colorado?
Right.
No,
like I said, it's the rule of the land. It's the letter of the law. It's in the rule books. So if the Sharks hadn't got their foot off the ice, I'd be saying, you know, it's just stupid.
Yeah.
It's a stupid, stupid thing for you to not just get off the ice.
It's right? Just mind-boggling to me that it was Landeskog, of all people, who did this.
Yeah.
Their captain. It'd be like Pavelski doing this, right? There would be such a kick, like wow, how is that? How could he be so... not smart, the so nice way of putting
not
it.
Not smart. Right. Yeah, that's good. Wow, okay. So I think we'll go ahead and that's good all we're going to talk about with the offside stuff. So let's go ahead and do our first little giveaway here. The little cooler, it's a can cooler, I guess. You can get the bottle cooler or whatever.
Right.
If you are listening and you've made it this far, first of all, congratulations. And then secondly, go ahead and put in the comments whatever your comment is, and maybe stack these up because there will be a few of them. But hashtag... cooler, okay? So COOLER, hashtag cooler. And that will enter you into a sort of a raffle, if you will, with everybody else who's interested that wants the cooler, okay? So
perfect.
We're good there. Yeah. All right. So what's the next thing we want to talk about? I think it was Martin Jones.
Jonesy.
Right? Yeah.
Jonesy, I think, had a great series. Even though it went to the seven games, I thought he played really well. I don't think there was too many games. There were no games like in Vegas where he had to get pulled.
Yeah.
He kept the Sharks in practically every single game. Let's look at his stats real quick. His against Colorado in this series, he had a 2.29 goals against average and a .916 save percentage. Mm-hmm. His career average is .223 goals against average and .922 save percentage. So pretty close, but also some room to improve.
Right.
So I think we can see a better Jones than what we have, which is amazing because I thought he's been looking pretty good.
Yeah.
But I mean, you juxtapose that to his season stats this year. On the season, he was 2.94 and .896. So we kept saying all year he's going to be playoff Jones, playoff Jones.
Yeah.
And so far he's delivered after game four of the first round.
Right.
So the first round, you take away those first four
Even
games.
Even then, the first game of that round, he didn't do too bad. It was really games 2, 3, and 4 where he just kind of fell apart there. And I almost, again... he fell apart. And for people on the podcast, I'm doing air quotes. Again, this is something that is a team effort. There's five guys in front of him, right? And, you know, if they're playing solid defensively around him, his numbers are going to improve. If they don't play solid defensively around him, his numbers are going to decline. His numbers are very much a factor of the five-man unit that plays in front of him. So it's very difficult to just take a look at his goals against average and save percentage and say, oh, he's hot garbage.
Right.
Right? So, and I think that was one of the things that we've seen kind of throughout these playoffs. We've been talking about, you know, more towards the end of the regular season.
Right.
So, I mean, again, once we get into this whole thing with the Blues, we'll see how it goes. But
I think it's just easy for people to find a single scapegoat for problems. And they go, oh, Martin Jones is terrible. We do so much better with, like, say, Bobrovsky or something, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah, like Bobrovsky. Gosh, that's not been brought up at all during
ever.
This show. Yeah.
Ever. anyway, one key factor who is missing in games 2, 3, and 4.
Yes, Marc-Edouard Vlasic, right?
Marc-Edouard Vlasic is the engine that drives the defense. And yeah, he's on defense, and he's on the defensive pairings, and the forwards have to help out a lot, too. Mm-hmm. But without Marc-Edouard Vlasic, this team seems to be doomed. So he is what makes the team go, which is kind of surprising, because he's so quiet. He does things so subtle that I don't think a lot of people pick up on it.
Yeah.
I mean, not quite San Jose fans. I think a lot of people in San Jose understand, but outside of that, which is why, you know, we talked with Doug Wilson about this, and he said that Vlasic should have been up for a trophy, and you had a good point with him.
Yeah, I had talked to him about, you know, having two different trophies, essentially, for defensemen, right? Mm-hmm. The Norris, kind of the best defensive defenseman, and then the Orr, Bobby Orr, for, like, the best offensive defenseman. And I think, you know, in that case, you'd have, like, Vlasic going up for the Norris, and then Brent Burns going up for the Orr, right? Kind of showcasing both of their abilities, and for all defensemen that are in the league, kind of separating them out and really recognizing what each individual defenseman is really good at, instead of just having one trophy that kind of lumps them all into one category. Oh, you're just kind of the best. Well, what makes you the best, right? It's hard to say. If getting the most points on the blue line makes you the best, then okay, it's one guy. If not allowing anybody to get any points from the other team on the blue line is makes you the best, well, then that's a different thing. So
I think it's a big hot topic, too.
Yeah.
A lot of people like to debate about this. I mean, Drew Doughty weighed in on Brent Burns, right? So I think that's a good idea. And I also, on a similar topic, I like to add a Wayne Gretzky Award for assists, because they have the Maurice Rocket trophy for the most goals. Why not have one for assists?
Mm, I like that.
I'm just trying to create trophies for
that's fine. Joe Thornton. On the topic of team defense, though, one thing that was very important to team defense was the faceoff percentages.
Yes.
Yeah.
Let's see. The Sharks in this series against Colorado won 67.9% of the faceoffs, which is amazing.
Nuts.
I mean, we kind of noticed, not every game, but most games, they were winning by a little bit, not a ton like that. I mean, leading him, Hurdle took the most faceoffs. He led the team in the number of faceoffs, and he was at 57.6%, which is really good. Goudreau, another one, 58.7%. I mean, that controls the play, the start of the play.
Yeah.
And a lot of those were also shorthanded faceoff wins.
Right.
So
for both of those two guys.
Right. Yeah. So they both play on the PK. So just amazing job that they did in the faceoff circle. I think a lot of that has to do with experience in a way, because Colorado's a younger team. Mm-hmm. McKinnon also got hurt in game 7, which I'm sure hurt them because he didn't take a faceoff. But he's not really the main faceoff guy anyway. So it's just it starts there. I mean, that's really where you're on a PK, you start in your own zone. If you can win that faceoff 58% of the time, you're at least dumping that puck,
right?
Hopefully.
Yeah, and you know, we had talked about you know, Barclay Goodrow taking faceoffs, being on the ice, and it's not necessarily going to be a matchup fourth line against fourth line. Again, he's doing that mostly on the PK, right? So he's going up against their top players, essentially, in the faceoff dot. So really important for him to be able to win those faceoffs in their zone, on the PK, get control of that puck right away, dump it down, kill off a good 10, 15 seconds of the power play, or, you know, your PK right off the bat. So, and this is one of the things that you wanted to have, I believe it was an Arizona Coyote, a former Coyote player on the team in free agency, because he was really, really phenomenal at faceoffs. I can't remember his name right now.
Vermette.
Thank you, Vermette. Yeah. And this was one of the things that Aaron wanted, was a guy who can play on the fourth line, and you just throw him out there for faceoffs. And looks like Barclay Goodrow is a guy that's going to play on the fourth line, and he's out there for faceoffs for the PK. So this is one of Aaron's wish lists, and we had it, and we didn't even realize that we had it. So, you know, again, just a great job by Doug Wilson putting this team together, is really what it comes down to.
Definitely.
And on that same note, we're going to go ahead and actually give away the mini stick before I get to that. So, hashtag mini stick, and it's this guy. I'll just pull it off the wall here. It's this guy right here. So, there is a mini stick, playoff mode. Put hashtag mini stick in your comment, and we will be giving this one away as well. So, going back to the team depth. What I wanted to say was that all lines are contributing, really. I mean, we saw Jonas Donskoy even on the fourth line in the game 7. He potted a goal. and you know,
a very similar looking goal.
Yeah, it's interesting because somebody brought that up in the live, and I'm like, I'm pretty sure this is the same goal that he scored against Pittsburgh.
Seen this before.
Yeah, so you know, he walks around behind the net on his forehand side, spins around hard, shoots it high, short side, goes right up and over in the corner, and you know, there ended up being the game-winning goal in both cases. Mm-hmm. So, really awesome job by Jonas Donskoy there to get himself back in the lineup. And again, this is a guy that was playing on the second line, if you want to call it the second line for the Sharks, and they put him down in the low utilization line, and he, though he only played 7 minutes, I think is what it was,
had
one shot on goal. That's
needed.
Efficiency right there. Super Key Grip Joe, that was his comment. That's efficiency. So yeah, all lines really contributing and clicking. You know, the Joe Thornton line, when they're not, they were playing really well in the first series. This series against Colorado, maybe not so much, but you know what? We're lucky to have a really solid top nine. Again, those other two lines with, you know, Hurdle centering and Couture centering. When Jumbo's line isn't putting the puck in the net and they're not producing, we got another top six worth of players that are able to do that. So whenever any one player is kind of sagging a little bit, or any one line is sagging a little bit, we have enough depth on the team to really kind of take over. And we also saw that on the blue line, mm-hmm. right? We saw Erik Karlsson maybe having a bit of a rough go, I think, especially in the Colorado series. Well,
Colorado series, he only had 3 assists, I believe.
Yeah, but he looked better in the Colorado series.
Skating
yes.
looked better. But he was offensively doing more, I think, in the Vegas series.
Okay.
But that could have been, you know, matchups and all kinds of other stuff. So, he does look better and healthier, and he was getting healthier every day. His skating was getting much better. So I think he's going to look even better and hopefully kind of combine it all and get it all together for the next series against St. Louis.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's the idea and that's the hope. You know, the longer that we play, and especially like we had talked about in the lives, is – you know, playing against a team like Colorado, they're not that heavy team that Vegas is, and not the heavier-ish team that we think the Blues will be. They're a team that's going to try to beat you with speed. They're not going to be able to wear you down physically as much. Now, they do have a few guys that are throwing the body out there, but they're not the type of team that's going to wear you down.
Yeah.
So hopefully, you know, we're dealing with fatigue, and that's it, and we're not getting any more bumps and bruises, and, you know, guys like Erik Karlsson and Joe Pavelski should be coming back feeling a lot better, feeling a lot healthier, and hopefully playing better as well.
And like I said, I think in our last live show, I'm glad that the Sharks played Vegas first and then Colorado, not the other way around, playing Colorado first and then Vegas, which would have happened if the Sharks had won the division.
Mm-hmm.
They would have played Colorado as the wild card team, since they would have won the division, and then they would play the winner of Vegas-Calgary, which we'll assume it's Vegas, then going into this series against St. Louis, they would have been a lot more banged up than they are.
Yeah.
So I think it's better result the way it worked out.
Yeah.
So who knew? Not winning a division, right?
And no matter which way you slice it, it's going to be difficult to get to the Stanley Cup finals.
Both 7-game series.
Exactly.
Yeah. And there was a question actually posed to us on Twitter about do you think the Sharks are going to be fatigued going into this round? Well, if you look at St. Louis, they just came off of a 7-game series themselves, where game 7 was a double overtime. In their first round, they went to 6 games. So they played one less game, and that was well over 2 weeks ago that they got that little extra rest. So, no, I don't think fatigue is going to play an issue. I don't think St. Louis is going to be just as tired and banged up as the Sharks have been. And I think playing against Dallas was a little heavier team than Colorado.
Yeah.
So they probably have a lot more bumps and bruises than the Sharks do at this point.
Yeah, and I don't think that the Sharks are going to take it easy on the Blues by any means. I think, you know, we've got guys that are going to throw the body around out there as well.
Mm-hmm.
Although, you know, again, we talked about Evander Kane potentially dealing with something right now. He just hasn't really looked like himself. Although in Game 7, he did look like he was charging around and having a little bit more free roam, if you will. So hopefully he starts feeling better too. But again, that's kind of what was the nice thing about the Colorado series was, yes, it was difficult, but it wasn't so much physically degrading, if you will. We weren't getting as many hits and bumps and bruises and injuries and everything that were going on in that series. But they were just a faster team, and that's what made them so difficult. So we're going to shift now from you know, going from a team that was Vegas, that was heavy and highly skilled, right, to a team that, like Colorado, that had a very, very highly skilled top line, but weren't going to beat you with much else, right? If that you shut that one line down, you have a really good opportunity to win that game. Mm-hmm. Although in some cases, that wasn't the case. And then we're going to be moving on to a Blues team who's maybe got a little mixture of the two, right? They feel a little bit heavier, but they are highly skilled. A guy like Tarasenko. So there's a lot to look forward to in this series. And you know, the one thing I was saying also in the lives was San Jose Sharks, they can win it any way you'd like. Mm-hmm. You can play that heavy game against them, they can still win. You can play that speed game against them, the high school game, they can still get off the win. St. Louis is kind of a little bit of both, and I think the Sharks are going to be able to kind of play it both ways in this series as well.
Yep. I think St. Louis is a little more deeper than Colorado, like you said. I think they have a good top nine, but their top nine is more... They have a couple rookies in there that are right. sprinkled in that aren't super high scoring guys. I mean, I guess you can say the same about the Sharks.
Yeah.
And Sorensen hasn't really scored much. I mean, that's kind of like some of the guys that we want to see kind of step up in the series because they weren't really there. One of them is LeBanc. He had one goal. It was a beauty in the first game, but then he disappeared. So we need him to step up on that third line. Thornton, that whole third line.
Sure.
Thornton, Sorensen, and LeBanc. And then, again, you say Kane. Something's wrong with him.
Right.
And then hopefully Carlson gets going again.
Yeah.
So those three guys, I think, could be the ones that step up in this next round, take the little pressure off of Hurdle and Couture, who are practically carrying the team at this point, and Burns. Burns is the other one.
Right.
So, I mean, what's great about having Burns and Carlson, you contain Carlson, you're not dealing with Burns, and we saw it in Colorado.
Yeah.
Maybe they contain Burns, or they focus on Burns. St. Louis does, right? Yeah. And then EK65 gets a little bit more time.
You know what the hilarious thing about that is? Pickle scored two goals.
There's another
game,
right?
So you shut down the big offensive threats, and still, even then, that game, it was Pickle scored two, and Burnsy scored the other goal, too.
Right.
So all the goals from that game came from the blue line.
Three goals, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's it's one of those things, again, if Jumbo's line isn't doing it, the other guys can pick it up. If for some reason Hurdle's line has kind of like they have a lapse, Jumbo's line can pick up the slack there, you know? So
it's like you're in a leaky rowboat and poking the holes to try and cover them, and one keeps popping up. You just can't do it.
Yeah. Well, whatever. It is what it is. Yeah. So we'll go ahead and do another giveaway. Actually, we're going to do a pair of giveaways. I believe we're going to do the hat.
Yes.
Right? So this hat right here, as well as the socks, which I was going to keep the socks, but I've since said, you know, it's... We're going to go ahead and give them to the community. They've earned them.
Paul has not worn them.
I've not worn them yet.
Fair warning.
Yeah. So there's no warning there. It's just a public service announcement. These are...
Who wants your dirty socks?
These are clean. So there you go. So hashtag socks if you would like to try to win the socks. And then hashtag hat if you would like to win the hat. These hashtags are very boring. Pretty much straight into the point, though. So... Anyway, is what it is. Good. So let's go ahead and move on. Let's talk about some of the Blues, the preview of the series, right? So there was a Facebook post, actually just a guy in the Facebook Sharks user group there who was a St. Louis Blues fan, but he was very cordial and very nice, and I guess that's why they let him in. His name was Drew. I'm not going to say his last name because A, I don't think he wants me to, and B, I can't remember it anyway. but Drew was there, and he offered up some points about the Blues and things to look out for and blah, blah, blah. And I wanted to take just one of the points that he had raised, and I think actually you might be talking about one of them that he raised as well. But my point that he wanted to raise and tell Sharks fans about was that on the power play for the St. Louis Blues, it's very predictable, and that what you'll find is they just pass, find Vladimir Tarasenko. Like, that's their whole strategy, right? Is to just keep passing it around until there's an open lane for Vladimir Tarasenko. So I think it's kind of the same as, say, like the Washington Capitals, for instance, right? Pass. Is Ovechkin open yet, right? Yeah. And just kind of let him fire the puck. Now, I don't know if Tarasenko is just a trigger man or if it's like get him the puck and allow him some room to skate.
Probably a little bit of both.
Maybe a little bit of both,
He's a very high-skilled goal scorer, so he's going to be elite. Kind of like... I mentioned this again in the live. Kind of like McKinnon, but I mean, not the same type of player as McKinnon. McKinnon's more speed and skill.
Yeah.
Tarasenko is more kind of like Ovechkin in a way. Mm-hmm. Very elite goal scorer. So if you give him time and space, you're going to pay for it.
Yeah.
So the Sharks are going to have to be all over him, and probably that's going to be the Vlasic Burns line is going to be matched up mostly against them to shut them down.
Yeah.
So he's... there's a reason why they keep passing, you know, trying to find him.
No doubt. Well, one way to keep the puck away from him, though, is, again, what we talked about, winning faceoffs.
Yep.
Right? And it sounds like the Sharks are doing a very good job of that, at least in the Colorado series. Hopefully that bleeds over to the Blues series, and there are some stats that kind of make us think that that might be the case.
Right. I mean, just looking at their faceoff percentage from the Dallas series that they just wrapped up, their team was at 46.3%, which is not good.
Yeah.
And Ryan O'Reilly, you didn't write it down there, but it was below 50%. So he took the most faceoffs. Hurdle took the most for the Sharks, and he was 56. 57.6.
Right.
And O'Reilly was under 50. So this is going to be kind of an advantage for the Sharks. Mm-hmm. Hopefully they can take advantage of it and they don't magically lose their faceoff prowess. But I would like, I expect to see the Sharks winning more than losing their faceoffs, which is going to help control the puck, which the Sharks are very good at.
Yeah.
Their Corsi ratings are astronomical. So I think this is going to help them in the advanced stats community and area.
Yeah, I mean, I hope so. Now, the funny thing is you brought up Brian O'Reilly, and yeah, he was kind of touted as one of the better faceoff guys in the league, but he was having a really rough go. So mm-hmm. I kind of wonder, maybe he's dealing with an injury or something as well. I don't want to really speculate, but if this is a guy who would normally have, you know, be phenomenal in the faceoff circle, and he wasn't doing quite so hot, again, this could be one of those luck things for the San Jose Sharks, mm-hmm. in the same way that McKinnon maybe had his bit of an injury, had to leave the game, come back, wasn't quite himself, in fact, didn't take faceoffs because he wasn't going to win any of them. Perhaps this is another luck thing for the San Jose Sharks with Ryan O'Reilly. However, the Blues are a much deeper team, I think, than some of the competition that we've faced so far, particularly Colorado. Yep. I think they're similar to the Sharks in that way, that they have a lot of depth. And we take a look at their top six line, or their top six forwards, the top two lines, and they do look like a very, very solid team. But then you go down another line, and you see it was centered by Bozak, I believe. Mm-hmm. This young kid, Rob Thomas, or yeah, Robert Thomas, I think is what his name.
What? Like the singer?
No, I don't know. Is it
Matchbox 20?
Matchbox 20? Yeah, no. Probably not that guy.
I have no idea who played hockey.
Yeah, I don't think so. Anyway, I think his name is Robert Thomas. Maybe I'm wrong on that. I don't know. He's a young kid, and he's playing really, really well. He doesn't have much on the score sheet, but when you look at the highlight reels and you look at him, confidence with the puck and skating around, and you know, stick handling and whatnot, he's weaving in and out of guys. He's you know, kind of fallen, taking a knee, pulled the puck to himself, got back up and kept skating with it. So he's got a lot of heart. He's got a lot of drive. And again, this is where I've been saying in the Colorado series, mm-hmm. with these young guys who are playing all confident, hit them, like to get them out of their comfort zone, get them second guessing themselves. You know, this is the NHL. Do I really belong here? You know, and if you're constantly getting on this guy and you're making him feel like maybe he doesn't belong, you need to. That's going to hurt his confidence. And I think you need to do that, especially because the St. Louis Blues are a bit of a deeper team, right? And they have three lines that can score on you. So, I mean, let's not forget Tyler Bozak. He's, you know, a decent center, but he was the number one center in Toronto until they blew up, right?
That's so because Toronto didn't have much.
They didn't have, but in other words, he was getting ice time.
That's like saying Chris Tierney is the top guy in Ottawa.
But he is. He's a top guy in my heart. But no, Tyler Bozak, I mean, he was getting the minutes is my point, right? So he was seeing, you know, the other top teams. So now he's more playing a third line role. So he's probably going to be seeing, you know, Jumbo, a whole heck of a lot.
Same as Jumbo.
Yeah.
He was a top line center for years.
Exactly. But I mean, but look what Jumbo's brought us, right?
Right.
Look how much skill that Jumbo has brought to that third line, that depth that we have. I think Bozak kind of brings the same thing to the St. Louis Blues. So something for us to look out there. Now, the difference in my mind between the depth of the Sharks and the depth of the Blues is the blue line. Mm-hmm. And the Blues' blue line isn't quite the same as the Sharks' blue line, but
nobody's blue line is
like our blue line.
It's still good.
Yeah.
Pietrangelo is a very good defenseman. Pareko is another young guy who is supposed to be kind of underperforming slightly for what he should be. So they got some really good guys and puck-moving defensemen on their back end. And I think that was a key difference that guy brought up right in the Facebook post. Mm-hmm. In the Dallas series was that they had some guys that were able to move the puck up.
Yeah.
And against them, that was their problem too, right? They couldn't contain the Dallas defensemen that were moving the puck up as well.
Which bodes well for the San Jose Sharks for two reasons. One, again, we have two extremely potent puck-moving defensemen back there. But we're also winning a lot of the faceoffs right now, and that helps us start with the puck. And especially, you know, in any zone, really, when you win a faceoff, it's probably going to go back to one of your defensemen. Mm-hmm. And these are the guys that are going to start the play. So if they're having a hard time dealing with other teams' puck-moving and offensive defensemen, one of the best things we can do is win the faceoff right away to our puck-moving and elite defensemen, right? So it's going to bode well for us, I think, I hope.
Yep.
Right?
Yeah. I think... going on to the back end, the next key, Jordan Binnington. He's this rookie goalie. He's got about 32, 33 NHL games before the playoffs. He's been playing great, However, there seemed to be some kind of chink in his armor against Dallas. So, and what I'm talking about is the penalties that he took.
Okay.
In one game, he took two different penalties. So they got under his skin. So I'm expecting kind of like if you get some guys in his face, kind of like how we did with Marc-Andre Fleury, I think he's going to lose his cool and it could cost them a penalty or two, you know? And you throw a guy off of his game when you get into his head like that.
Yeah.
So I want the Sharks to move in rent-free into Binnington's head and keep in front of him and make sure that he is not on his game.
Yeah.
Because he's a good goalie. He had a 2.18 goals against in that series and a .922 save percentage. So he plays well. He has good defensemen in front of him.
Right.
The Sharks just need to get in front of the net and get him off of his game.
Something I think the Sharks have struggled with quite a bit, actually, is getting in the eyes and getting in those lanes, right, where you're making the goalie kind of have to squat and look around. Mm-hmm. There are too many times I've seen, you know, Brent Burns fire one in from the point, but it's visible.
Right to the goalie.
Right to him, right in the crest. It. Yeah.
It's like, oh, thanks, I'll catch that.
So I think that's one thing that the Sharks can definitely work on is getting into the goaltender's eyes. And it's not just for Binnington, it's for any goalie in the league. Again, I said this during the live twice, I believe. You know, blindfold yourself and have someone throw you a tennis ball. I'm pretty much not going to catch that ball unless they tell you exactly where it's going. But, you know, with a guy like he might catch it, he says. With a guy like Binnington, you know, he's, again, young and confident. Now, my solution there is not chuck the goalie, but what you want to do is, you know, frustrate him, get in his eyes where he has to move around. You know, maybe back in just a little bit more than you would into the crease. You know, you don't want to get a goalie interference penalty, obviously, but, you know, maybe just get him a little uncomfortable, make him rattle a little claustrophobic.
Rattle him a bit.
Yeah, so the shot comes. He, you know, gloves it down, makes a save before the whistle goes. Yeah, hack at that glove just once. You know, that's all you need to do. Just upset him just a little bit because, again, he's young. Mm-hmm. He's got all the physical tools and he's got the reaction timing. He's got all the skills that it takes to be a really good goalie in this league, clearly. But it's the mental side of the game for the younger folks. You know, if it's a veteran goalie, you're not going to knock him off his game. For a young guy, you know, that's the only way you're going to get him off of his mechanics is getting inside of his head.
Mm-hmm.
So there you go. And speaking of heads, the last of our giveaways, I'm going to keep your head warm. And this guy's head, you know it's cold all the time. Hashtag Beanie. You sure you don't want to keep this one now?
Yeah, I'm sure.
Okay. So hashtag Beanie, B-E-A-N-I-E, hashtag Beanie. And that'll get you entered to win that fine piece of equipment right there. So there you go.
Nice. Fun fact about St. Louis. They've been to the Stanley Cup Finals 3 times in their existence. They've won a combined 0 games. They've been swept 3 times. Now, this is when the NHL expanded and they were in the West and there were not a lot of strong teams in the West. Okay. So all the strong teams were in the East. So whoever won the West, which happened to be St. Louis 3 years in a row, they just got destroyed.
Oh my God.
But they got swept 3 times.
That's terrible.
So they've never won a Stanley Cup playoff game. The Sharks have been in the Stanley Cup Finals once and have won 2 games.
Okay.
So just throwing that out there. So anyway,
I would rather be 2-for-4 than 0-for-12.
But my point is, right? They've been around since I think the 60s.
Yeah.
That's a long drought Stanley Cup Finals. In fact, I don't even know if they haven't been back to the finals since those first 3.
Really?
So they go way back.
Wow.
So for Sharks fans who are commiserating, there's Blue fans that have double the amount of years than we do in terms of not having a cup or even going to the cup.
Yeah. No, the Blues Nation is on high alert right now.
Right.
Getting ready to go. Hey, you know, it's going to be a great series. It's going to be a lot of exciting stuff. And I do encourage you guys to subscribe to us because the way that we do this show during the playoffs has been to do the live show after each game, or actually just after the third period ends.
Right.
And a lot of times we're sitting here when overtime's going on. So we're watching the TV down here and it's fun because, you know, we're getting the reactions, or you guys are getting the reactions from us. So I would definitely recommend the sub so that you know when we are going live. You get those notifications and you can partake. And the live segments are just a blast.
I also want to comment on the community that we have, because we have a lot of regulars that come in and watch us and comment. And we also pick up fans from the other teams. And both series, the Vegas series and the Colorado series, very cordial people, which is great. So you can have a different opinion. That's fine. You can be a fan of the other team, and that's fine. But, you know, don't be mean. Yeah. Just, you know, have good comments, and we will respond as such. So it's a good time. It's great to join, and it is moderated, so there won't be any foul language or anything.
And I'll let you guys in a little bit behind the scenes right now, because when Aaron and I sat down to shoot this episode, it was difficult for the first time in a long time, because we've done so many live shows now that we've forgotten how to do the recorded content.
This
so,
is true.
Yeah, no, it's legitimately, I'm not even kidding. So, yeah, no, but hey, great to get back in the saddle again, shoot another show for you guys, and then we're just going to do it all over again. Hopefully not 7 more live streams,
right?
But we'll see. We'll see how it goes. So I know.
Our producer back there is moaning.
Super producer Jason would like to get some sleep, he says, as much as he loves the Sharks. So hopefully we sweep. That would be great.
It'd be great.
But we're not gonna expect it. So
if it happens, I'm putting a broom on the set.
There you go. Very good. Okay. Anything else you want to bring up here?
Just if you'd like to support the show, you can go to our website at www.thefinfactor.com, and we are running a promo still of 10% off, and the code is playoff mode. You can enter that in, and 10% off your entire order, whatever you put in your cart. That's a great way. It helps us, and you get something out of it. And if and when you do buy stuff, we've already gotten a few of these, send us a picture of you wearing your stuff, and we will put it on the show.
Yeah. Yeah, no, we got some really interesting pictures last time around. We got, you know, the hat and the shirt and everything else, and we got someone taking a picture of the hat with a toaster. If you don't know what that's about, check out the live streams, and you'll pick it up really fast. So... Yeah. Very good. Okay, anything else?
I think that's it.
Good to go. Okay, well, hey, guys, thank you so much for tuning in. We do appreciate it, and we can't wait to see you guys in the lives. But we will see you...
Saturday night.
Saturday night. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thanks for tuning in. If you like this episode, check out our other content, especially interviews. You can interact with us directly through social media at TheFinFactor and on Instagram at FinFactor. And don't forget to join our live streams on YouTube.
Visit our website at TheFinFactor.com, where you'll find all of our episodes as videos or podcasts. You'll also find our exclusive merchandise to help support our show.